Good morning, folks. We've got an exciting lineup today. We hit U.S. and international weather, do a little special report on Hurricane Dorian's space weather forcing, and we hit the top science news. But we begin at spaceweathernews.com looking at the last day on our star, and we find considerable calm. Coronal hole on the south turning out, leaving a largely featureless Earth-facing half of the sun. The solar wind managed to find stability after days of fluctuating telemetry and phi angle flips. This has led to finally ending the geomagnetic reverberations and small-scale instabilities. Next stream could arrive as early as today. Let's look in on Colorado, because the storms that ripped through here last night brought serious hail, even a few tornadoes. The lightning storm stretched northward and lit up wildfires across Oregon, over 100 of them. Folks, this is the 7-day KP index charts from various locales, and up top in blue running across is the Dorian wind speed. As we saw with Patricia and numerous other storms, the intensity of the wind speed can be modulated by the geomagnetic conditions and induced electric current. Excellent work here by one of the observers to make a graphic showing yet another forcing event. Let's remember that solar flares and CME impacts over the storm drive it westward. Geomagnetic conditions can modulate its strength. Speaking of storms, as one typhoon runs up into Asia, a tight, powerful one is heading right for Tokyo. This is made even more concerning by their blood echoes nearby this morning, eyes on Japan for both typhoon conditions and increased seismicity. Couple interesting stories here. First is a visual piece by the SVS showing the ice sat's coverage and ice depth readings tracked and collated to offer a picture of changing ice thickness. Up next, they have measured the width of a proton to be 5% lower than believed. This is after a study showed it to be 4% smaller, which kind of makes me wonder if they've gotten it wrong throughout the past, or perhaps if something is changing. Up next, we dive deep into the mantle, the swirling liquid rocks and metal interior. It is the focus today as Caltech examines planetary collisions, which they say not only eject material from the planet, but puff it out. And in its lower mass and greater volume state, its interior density changes allow for essentially the reorganization and creation of a new planet when it finally calms and condenses again. So folks, this old paper is one of the great classics when they first realized that a nuclear core could never really produce the sunspot cycle. The question remains unanswered today as the number one geophysics journal in the world revisits the issue. They do describe how the sun's 11-year cycle varies a good bit, but over the longer time scales, the clock cycles match up almost exactly. This would be the Gleisberg cycle of 88 years, the grand cycles of 200 and harmonic 400 years, the Hallstatt cycle of 2,400 years, and yes, probably also the 12,000-year cycle of the sun. There is something other than a nuclear core responsibility for these cycles, and it manages to hold near perfection while confusing the world as to what it really is. Last but not least, folks, the space weather hurricane connection we revisited this morning is just one of the forcing features that has been discovered. There are numerous others, and interestingly, the most important come down to mundane details in the modeling. In a terrific paper, we have three critical findings. First, they advise extreme caution in extrapolating future warming trends from the short trends we do have on the record. Second, this warming would be highly sensitive to uncertainties in the modeled emissions and those emissions' effects on clouds. This is what Princeton discovered 2 years ago. And last but not least, that tuning the models to historical data leaves models 100% dependent on those historical data accuracies. This means that 1. Warming warnings are guesses. 2. The cause of the warming may not be so easily attributable to human emissions. And 3. And most critically, if they don't get things like the sun or volcanoes correct over historical time, the models will fail. Heard that before? Folks, I would have never had the guts to do that climate video if the writing wasn't on the wall, if the IPCC hadn't allowed particle forcing for the upcoming report, and if the dozens of professors I speak to on a regular basis didn't tell me the course was about to change. It is not only critical that you watch and share the climate forcing movie, linked below the video with the other two movies we put out last month, but that you also share that critical perspective and the critical facts that make this topic worth listening to. We greatly appreciate your support. We've got wind map forecasts and shots of our star to close, and we'll do this all again tomorrow, right here, but right now it's 4:55 a.m. in the new Valley of the Sun. Eyes open, no fear. Be safe, everyone.